Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Today I'm going to be reviewing two products by Leaptrend, the 60 amp DC-DC charger and the 3000 watt inverter. Okay, so first up is the DC-DC battery charger. So anyone who has an RV, a trailer, a camper van, really anything with an engine that you want to pull some power from to charge your off-grid batteries, you're going to need one of these. Right now in my setup, I have the Renogy DC-DC charger and I really like it, but I do have a few issues with it. So I'm excited to take that one out, install this one and test this one out. They offer three different models, a 20 amp, a 40 amp and a 60 amp. And one of the features that I'm really excited about this is they do have a 50% capacity. So that's the reason why I went with the 60 amp. 60 amps is a lot to pull from your alternator unless you have a larger alternator. I have a 90 amp alternator. So 60 amp is gonna be too much for it. On highway speeds, should be fine. I am going to set it up so most of the time it's only pulling 30 amps, but when I'm on the highway, I'll be able to just flick a switch and then start pulling 60 amps. I'm probably not going to use that feature all that much. Right now I have that feature on my other charger. It usually only pulls 25 amps, but if I flick a switch, I can pull up to 50 amps. See what we got inside. Manual, little warranty card, and this is the unit itself. As far as size and weight go, this is honestly pretty standard. It's got a little bit of weight to it, but not too much. It seems like a really solid build. It's all made out of metal. Definitely nice quality there. One of the best parts about this charger is actually the price. It varies from $100 to $200. So that's very affordable when you're looking at DC to DC chargers. This charger is compatible with almost any type of 12 volt battery, including gel, flooded, lithium iron phosphate, and AGM. The smart protection features include overvoltage, over temperature, and reverse polarity, just in case you make a mistake while you're installing it. It works as a battery charger and a battery isolator at the same time, for those of you that don't know. So this basically just ensures that you won't drain your starter battery for your vehicle, which is really important, or else you'll just be stuck in the middle of nowhere. It also has three-stage charging to get your batteries up to 100%. Depending on which type of battery you have, this will vary. A couple quick install tips. Make sure to size the wires going in and out properly. They have a chart in their manual, which is really helpful. Not only do they have the wire sizes, but they also have the fuse ratings. I would recommend using a 12-volt breaker just in case you have to isolate this or reset it for any reason. It makes it a lot easier. Also, if you're way out in the middle of nowhere and you blow a fuse and you don't have a spare, you're kind of stuck. If you have a breaker, you can just manually reset it or disengage it as required. I would also recommend connecting your DC to DC charger directly to your alternator, or making sure that the cable going from your alternator to your battery is large enough when you're putting a larger charger on. Because if you just have a 4-gauge wire running from your alternator to your battery, but this requires a 2-gauge wire, then you're gonna be running those wires really hot. You're probably gonna have problems melting wires, that sort of thing. So on this side, you have your battery selecting dial, which has standard gel, AGM, lithium phosphate, and power. There is also a warning indicator. So if there is any problems with the charger, like over voltage, over temperature, those sorts of things, this thing will flash and then you'll have to come and check and see what's going on. Underneath the dial, you have your sensor switch for your battery temperature sensor. Next to that, you have a whole bunch of smaller connections here. So the most important ones are the D plus and the LC. The D plus is the ignition terminal. So you want to make sure that that's connected to your ignition switch. That's really important because if you connect it, say, directly to your battery, it's going to pick up 12 volts. This is going to turn on and it's going to drain your starter battery. So you want to make sure that that's connected to the right place. LC is the current limiting switch. That's what will tell this to draw 30 amps, which is half of the capacity. If you have the 20 amp DC to DC charger or the 40 amp, it'll do 10 and then 20. So it'll basically limit the current to 50% of whatever your charger is. Next to those ports, you have your output positive and your output negative, which you're going to connect to your house batteries. And then on the other side here, there is the input negative and the input positive, which you're going to connect to your alternator and then your battery ground. One thing that I don't like about this Leaptrend is it doesn't have a float charge for lithium batteries. What that means is this charger is going to charge your lithium batteries all the way up to full, to 100%, but then it's going to turn off. So that's one thing that I know this charger doesn't have that would be nice to see. Okay, guys, so got the cover off the DC to DC charger, and honestly, this looks really well built. Battery terminals, which, you know, can receive quite a bit of play sometimes, they're very solid on there. And this actually has removable fuses, which is really nice because the inverter had soldered fuses, which makes it really hard to change them, but these are actually removable and it's honestly really accessible. There's only four screws holding on the top cover. The whole thing pops off. You wouldn't even have to take this off the wall to access in here. You could just remove the cover. All right, on to the 3000 watt Leaptrend inverter. Inside the box, again, warranty card, manual. Here we actually have a remote switch with 20 feet of cable. That is really nice to have. I use my remote switch right now all the time. That's pretty much all I use. That is the remote switch. It's really simple. One button in the center there with a little indicating light. It also has the warning light if there's any problem, so you'll be able to see that remotely too and reset it. And this is the inverter. This is about half the size of my inverter charger right now. Granted, this isn't a battery charger, unfortunately. Just a 3000 watt pure sine wave inverter. Leaptrend also sells these in 700, 1000 and 2000 watt models. The price varies from about $100 for the 700 watt model to $300 for the 3000 watt model. These are pure sine wave inverters, which is the only way to go nowadays to be as efficient as possible. On the one side here, we have the input negative and the input positive. They look like really bulky battery connectors, which is nice, should make the install easier. They even have these little caps that cover them. They also have a small ground port on there as well. And then on this side right here, they have three GFCI outlets, which are a really nice touch. I'm not going to be using those very much because I'm going to be connecting directly to my breaker. So I'm going to be using these ports right here, but I will test out these ports once I get it installed. There is also a GF light right here to make sure that that connection is running smoothly. There's a USB connection and then the remote connection and then the on-off switch here along with the remote setting. And then right here is the small LCD display. One thing that makes Leaptrend stand out too is they have US models for their inverters and then they also have EU models for anyone living in Europe. Some of the protection features that this inverter has is low voltage disconnect, high voltage disconnect, AC overload, and over temperature, which will help protect the system really well. It also has an excellent surge rating of up to 2 times the power. Leaptrend is basically saying that this can surge up to 6,000 watts for a really short period of time. Right now, I only have a 2,000 watt inverter, and we could honestly use a 3,000 watt inverter because we recently started traveling around with an air fryer, which has really upped our cooking game, and that pulls a lot of power. So if we're using the air fryer and we want to use anything else, we can't, because that air fryer basically takes up all 2000 watts. Having a 3000 watt inverter will come in really handy. Got the cover off here and it looks fairly well built inside here, but the only thing I don't like is that the fuses in here are actually welded in. Pretty tough to replace those if they ever were to go. Other than that, everything looks really well built. I'm excited to get this installed and test it out. Got the inverter all installed and the DC to DC charger. Sorry, it's not super pretty, but I had to kind of shift things around to make it work. These components are obviously different sizes than my other ones. So let's go through the install here and I'll show you all the wires that I've connected and we can turn it on and test it out. I've mounted the inverter right to the wall here. It says in the manual that the only way you're not supposed to mount it is vertically on a vertical surface. So I'm assuming that that's kind of like orientated the other way. So horizontally on a vertical surface should be all right. I made sure that there's lots of clearance around it for airflow, just in case it gets hot. I also have the remote installed right here. First things first is we're gonna switch this switch up here to remote to test that out. And then we can go ahead and just click this button. It will power up there.
And you can see on the screen that we have 120 volts, 60 hertz, 0 watts coming out there. And then it also says 13.1 volts for the battery. Right here is the remote input. And then right here, I've connected my AC system. So this runs up to my breaker box, which is installed up there. And then from the breaker box, I have numerous outlets spread out throughout the vehicle. On the other side of the inverter here, we have the negative that goes to my negative bus bar. And then down underneath there, got the positive wire connected to my positive bus bar. And these are both fused as per the spec. The wire sizes are obviously bigger than what they say in the manual, but it's always safer to be on the bigger side as far as wires go. I've gone ahead and turned on my water heater, which draws about 125 amps. And then I'm gonna go ahead and turn on this space heater, which is gonna be drawing up to about 200 amps. Which is around 2,500 watts. All right, so space heater's going, water heater's going, and the inverter seems to be running flawlessly. It says on the screen that we're pulling about 2120 for wattage. So I've plugged in this orbital sander and we can fire this guy up and see what we get to. That brought us very close to 2,500 watts and without an issue at all. This inverter is working fantastic. It's not even getting like all that hot. You can hear the fans going, but honestly, it seems to be running without a problem, which is sweet. This is more than I've ever pulled on my system because I just have a 2,000 watt inverter regularly installed. So this is gonna be a nice upgrade. It's also gonna be really nice having these GFCI ports right on the side here. It's gonna be super easy to access them if I ever need to plug power tools into them or even like charge my phone with this USB port. It'll just make things super easy. One of the most common questions I get about inverters is what size should I get? It's always smart to go bigger. I did the 2000 watt inverter and I regret it. I wish I had a 3000 watt one. Even though I don't use over 2000 watts very often, it's always nice to have that 3000 watts because if I turn on my air fryer or my water heater and then I accidentally turn something else on, that could push it over 2000 watts. So I've tested this one up to 2500 watts and it's worked great. I don't want to push it all the way up to 3000 watts because my system isn't sized for taking that kind of power. And I don't want to do any damage to it. I'm sure this would handle it just fine, but it's always good to oversize these components and then not max them out. Now onto the DC to DC charger. So I have my red wire there that goes straight to my alternator. And then the negative on top there goes to the negative bus bar, which is grounded. And then on the other side here, we have the output, which runs to the fuse and then to my positive bus bar, which then connects to my battery. And then up here we have the negative, which goes to my negative bus bar, which is also grounded to the vehicle. Both these negative cables essentially go to the same place, the negative bus bar, which is grounded to the vehicle. I've set the dial switch to lithium phosphate. I have connected this wire goes to my ignition and this wire goes to the same place. So I should only be drawing about 30 amps, not the 60 amp. It would be really nice if I could connect this to some sort of sensor relay that would disengage when my vehicle hits like 2500 RPM or something like that. So I don't draw the total 60, but right now we're just gonna test this for the 30 amps. I just started up the van and you can see now that we are charging and getting just under 30 amps from the DC to DC charger. Now, if I wanted to pull 60 amps, which is what this charger is capable of doing, I could disconnect that LC switch and it would start pulling 60 amps. But because I'm only sitting here idling, I don't want to put a huge strain on my alternator and possibly damage any of the electronics because I've never pulled 60 amps. I've only pulled 50, which I know it's capable of doing without issue. If I was driving on the highway, it'd be a different story. I'd be comfortable pulling 60, but right now, just sitting here idling, I don't want to do that. You can see there the LFP is glowing green, which means obviously that it's charging. And then the warning light on the top here, that red one, isn't blinking. So must have done a good job installing it because it's working great.
All the products that I used in this video will also be linked in the description, including links to Leaptrend's DC-DC charger and their inverter. So if you want to check those out, they'll be in the description below. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you have any questions regarding Leaptrend or the installation process, please feel free to comment below and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. If you like this video, be sure to like it, subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you guys in the next one.